These nights are the nights of the great Wali of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Amir al-Mu'mineen, Imam al-Muttaqeen, Ali bin Abi Talib alayhi salatu wa salam. Inshallah, we'll try to understand this great man in the light of his own words, because we by ourselves don't have the capacity to know him in the full way. And when I say that, this is not just exaggeration, this is not poetry, this is actually the reality. There is a statement which is there from Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, the founder of the Hanbali, you know, fiqh of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, where he quotes a hadith from the Prophet, where the narration says, and this is Abdullah bin Mas'ud narrating, that I heard the Prophet saying, وَالَّذِي نَفْسِي بِيَدِهِ, by the one in whose hand is my life, referring to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, لَوْلَا أَن تَقُولَ تَوَائِفُ مِنْ أُمَّتِي فِيكَ مَا قَالَتِ النَّصَارَ فِي ابْنَ مَرْيَمْ. If I did not fear what a group of my ummah would say about you, like what the Christians say about Jesus, لَقُلْتُ الْيَوْمْ فِيكَ مَقَامًا, today I would have described you and your status in such a way that لا تمر بملأ من المسلمين إلا أخذوا التراب من تحت قدميك بالبركة. I would describe your status today, if I didn't have this fear, I would describe it in such a way that you would not pass by any group of Muslims, but that they would take the earth beneath your feet for their blessings and a barakah. And so what it means is that whatever Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has described about Amir al-Mu'mineen is not really to that level, because he is afraid. The way Christians ended up saying that Isa ibn Maryam is son of God, or God himself, or part of the Trinity, Rasulullah was afraid that if I really talk about the fadail of Ali the way I should, then there is a fear that a group from my ummah will do the same thing to Ali, what Christians have done to Isa. And this is what I mean when I say that, you know, we don't really have the capacity to understand Amir al-Mu'mineen in that way. And the best way is to go to himself. One way of understanding Ali is to see how he describes himself. Keeping that in mind, tonight I would like to share with you a statement from Amir al-Mu'mineen where he talks about his childhood. Although it is a narration of his childhood, but it is very important as far as our belief system and understanding of this greatness of the Wali of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ali bin Abi Talib alayhi salatu wa salam. In Nahj al-Balagha, there is a khutbah which is known as Al-Khutbatul Qasi'a, which is a very long khutbah and a very important khutbah on Nahj al-Balagha. And this is khutbah number 192. And before I go into it, let me just, you know, explain, because sometimes when we quote Nahj al-Balagha, immediately the question comes up that many of the sermons of Nahj al-Balagha don't have sanad, don't have sources. And so, you know, how can it be relevant to us or reliable as far as authenticity is concerned? This long khutbah, what I'm going to present actually is the last part of it, where Amir al-Mu'mineen talks about different issues in that khutbah, but at the end he talks about himself and his childhood. That segment of the khutbah, interestingly, can be seen in the writing of a scholar who actually lived about half a century before Sayyid Razi, who was the compiler of Nahj al-Balagha. Ahmad al-Hassani is a Zaydi scholar, And he, in his narration, basically brings this entire segment, the last part, where Ali talks about his own childhood, through his own sanad and chain of narration, going all the way to the sixth imam, from sixth imam going up to Imam Hussein ibn Ali, who says that my father mentioned these words in a sermon. According to Ibn Abil Hadid al-Mu'tazili, the timeline he gives us of that khutbah is that this is after the Battle of Nahrawan. So we are talking about the last years of the life of Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wa salam. And so the sanad of this part of this khutbah is, you know, an authentic sanad, and there is no issues here. This is where he says, قَدْ عَلِمْتُمْ مَوْضِعِي مِنْ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ بِالْقَرَابَةِ الْقَرِيبَةِ وَالْمَنْزَلِةِ الْخَصِيصَةِ. He says, you know my position regarding the Prophet. I was so close to him, and I had a special, you know, position with him. وَضَعْنِي فِي هِجْرِهِ وَأَنَا وَلِيدٌ. He basically took me under his charge and care when I was a child. Those of you who read history, you know that he was just 5 years old when Rasulullah took him from Abu Talib. This is the days when Abu Talib was going through financial difficulties. And so Abbas took Ali, Aqil, and Rasulullah took Ali. And Talib was left with Abu Talib there. And this is where we see that from that age of five, Rasulullah is... Amir al-Mu'mineen is now raised in the house of Muhammad and Khadija. Not only that, it says, وَكَانَ يَمْضَغُ الشَّيْءِ ثُمَّ يُلَقِّمِينِهِ. He, even when we used to sit down, if there was a meat which was hard, for example, he would chew it, make it soft, and then feed me. This is as far as his childhood is concerned. And then he says, وَمَا وَجَدَ لِي كَذْبَةً فِي قَوْلٍ وَلَا خَلْطَةً فِي فِعْلٍ. He says, even at that time, that age, you know, the Prophet did not find neither a lie in my speech nor any weakness in my action. This is Ali talking about himself as a child. And then he says, as a preamble to the revelation of the Quran in the cave of Hira, he says, as far as Rasulullah is concerned, and this is the belief that we have, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had assigned an angel to the Rasul from his childhood. This is Rasulullah's childhood, where he would be there all the time. So there are no issues of, you know, Rasulullah even in childhood making mistakes or doing this and that. No. This is the aqidah that we have as Shia, as Na'ashari. يَسْلُكُ بِهِ طَرِيقَ الْمَكَارِمْ وَمَحَاسِنَ أَخْلَاقِ الْعَالَمْ لَيْلُهُ وَنَهَارُهُ. Day and night, this malak was with Rasulullah, you know, basically taking him on the path of Tariqul Makarim. And what is that? This is the path of high character and good universal behavior. Mahasin akhlaq al-alam. Day and night. And then Ali now talks about himself, that the malak was there, the angel was there, assigned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to take care of Rasulullah. And then he says, وَلَقَدْ كُنْتُ أَتَّبِعُ اِتِّبَاعَ الْفَصِيلِ أَسَرَ عُمِّهِ. And I, as a child, I used to follow him like a young camel following the footprints of its mother. So whatever divine guidance and, you know, tarbiyat, if we may call it, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to Rasulullah was coming, you know, this is where Ali in his childhood is actually following, like a baby camel following the footsteps of its mother. يَرْفَعُ لِي فِي كُلِّ يَوْمٍ مِنْ أَخْلَاقِهِ عَلَمًا. Every day he would show me an example of his high akhlaq. وَيَعْمُرُنِي بِالْإِقْتِدَى بِهِ. And he would ask me to follow him and be with him. Salawat pranayak parawar. Then Ali starts talking about the time when he was 10 years old. This is the 40th year of the Amul Fil. The Prophet is also now 40 years old. And this is where he says, لَقَدْ كَانَ يُجَاوِرُ فِي كُلِّ سَنَةٍ بِحِرَى. Those days, those years, Rasulullah would always assign some time where he would go in isolation in the cave of Hira to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he would go for 3 days, sometimes even longer, sometimes even shorter than that. But there was no fridge in there. Where does the food and the drink come from? It used to come from home. And this is where it was Ali, who every day would take the food and go to see Rasulullah in the cave of Hira. This is where Ali says, فَعَرَاهُ وَلَا يَرَاهُ غَيْرِي. When Rasulullah used to go into isolation in the cave of Hira, فَعَرَاهُ, I used to see him, and no one else would see him. Nobody else was going there. وَلَمْ يَجْمَعْ بَيْتٌ وَاحِدٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ غَيْرَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ وَخَدِيجَةَ وَأَنَا ثَالِثُهُمَا. And those days when Islam started after the revelation of the Quran, you know, there was no house where Islam was there except in one house. And that was the house of Rasul and Khadija, and I was the third with them. Salawat par nek barar. Referring to the specific day, the 27th of Rajab, or is it 28th? Day of Baisat? What is it? 28? Okay, I'll ask you tomorrow. We'll see that. On that day of Baisat, when the first revelation came, five ayat, the first ayat which came down, اقرأ باسم ربك الذي خلق. We hear the story. Rasulullah didn't know. He was confused. He was suicidal. Even the narration says that. He actually would go onto the summit of the mountain to throw himself down. He used to think that, oh, maybe I have been possessed by jinn. Because what's happening to me? Until Khadija, according to the majority version, which is there, which is even taken by the Western historians, is that only when Khadija became very concerned about the state of mind of Rasulullah, she decided to take him to her cousin, Warqa bin Nawfal, an old man who was a learned scholar of the scriptures of the Jewish and the Christian tradition. He was a Christian himself. And only when they met him, he actually assured Rasulullah that this is not jinn. This is an angel who is coming to visit you. So mashallah, the entire Islam is based on the assurance given to our Rasul from a Christian scholar. He was a cousin of Khadija, yes. But he was an ordinary person, a Christian scholar. Look at the version of the person who says, فَأَرَاهُ وَلَا يَرَاهُ غَيْرِي. When Rasulullah was in that cave of Hira, I used to see him. Nobody else used to see him. What does he have to say? He's 10 years old. He says, أَرَى نُورَ الْوَحِي وَالرِّسَالَةِ وَعَشُمُّ رِيحَ النُّبُوَّةِ. I used to see the light of divine revelation and Risalat, and I used to breathe the scent of prophethood. This is Ali, not even Rasulullah himself. But he was there at that time when the wahi started. And he says, unlike what others say that he didn't know what's happening, Ali says, لَقَدْ سَمِعْتُ رَنَّةَ الشَّيْطَانِ هِنَ نَزَلَ وَحِي عَلَيْهِ. When the wahi and the revelation came first time to the Prophet, I heard a very loud cry of the shaitan. And Ali says, I didn't know who is this. فَقُلْتُ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ مَا هَذِهِ الرَّنَّةِ. What is this cry that we heard? فَقَالَ هَذَا الشَّيْطَانِ. Rasulullah says, this is a shaitan. قَدْ أَيْسَ مِنْ عِبَادَتِهِ. Now he has lost hope in his total domination of the human society. And this is where we come to realize Rasulullah knows what is happening. That this is wahi coming on to me. And this cry is the cry of the shaitan. And now he has lost hope in total domination of the human society with the beginning of the revelation of the Quran. So he is aware of what's going on. And this is where then Rasulullah does not only say that this cry is of the shaitan, then he says to Ali, إِنَّكَ تَسْمَعْ مَا أَسْمَعْ O Ali, you are able to hear what I hear. وَتَرَى مَا أَرَى And you are able to see what I see. إِلَّا إِنْ أَنَّكَ لَسْتَ بِنَبِيٍّ The only difference between me and you are not a Nabi, وَلَكِنَّكَ لَوَظِيرٌ You are the minister, إِنَّكَ لَعَلَى خَيْرٌ And you definitely are on the path of virtue. Salawat. Ghadir is much, much later on. This is Ali, who is just 10 years old. And so when you hear about it, you have to realize that, you know, we are not talking about this question sometimes we hear. Who was the first person who accepted Islam? So there's a division among the women is Khadija, among the men so-and-so, among the children is Ali. MashaAllah, now you divide them into age-wise. In other things, no. But when it comes to Ali, the issue is that even if you say he was the first child to accept Islam, tell me in which fiqh and Islamic laws is testimony of a child who is not baligh acceptable? So even if you say he was a child, but he was first, then you already are giving him a preference that his testimony of shahadat as a child is equal to somebody who is an adult. Salawat Pranay Akbar. About 20 years ago in Dehli, there was a seminar regarding Amir al-Mu'mineen, and there were many speakers from different school of thought, Shia, Sunni, non-Muslims. And a Pakistani Sunni scholar was there, and he made a very interesting comment. He says this whole discussion about whether Ali was the first to accept Islam is irrelevant to Ali. Because you will say that about somebody who was not a Muslim before. Somebody who is Islam, who is with Islam for his childhood. You don't ask this question, when did Ali become a Muslim? And therefore, you know, you can ask about others. Were they idol worshippers before and now they became Muslim? Were they Christians before and now they became a Muslim? They're followers of the Jewish faith and now they become Muslim? They're atheists before and now they become Muslim? When did they become a Muslim? Well, when it comes to the Ali from his childhood, he's there. Ala ara nur al-risala wa nubuwa. I see this light of risalat and nubuwat in the form of the Prophet. So for him, the question of when he became Muslim is irrelevant. And I'll go back to the example I used yesterday. You know, the qualities in individuals and things are sometimes incidental, sometimes essential. When you say Ali became a Muslim, or a mu'min, the quality of Islam and iman for Ali is just like the sweetness of the sugar or not the sweetness of the tea. If Ali was there, iman was there. You can't have Ali without iman. You can't even think of Ali without Islam. About others, you can say they were idol worshippers, they are mushrik, they were this and that, then they became Muslim. And this is where we see in the words of Amir al-Mu'mineen, Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wa salam himself, salawat. And as I said, this is a khutbah that he gave after Nahrawan. This is the third of the three battles that he had to fight against those who rebelled against him. And this is towards the end of his life there. The importance of this statement of Amir al-Mu'mineen in khutbah number 192 about being there in the cave of Hira when the first revelation came down is very important. If you go to the Quran in Surah Al-Ra'd, The last ayat there is very interesting. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the situation of Makkah. And he says to the Prophet, وَيَقُولُ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لَسْتَ مُرْسَلًا. That, O Muhammad, these who are non-believers, they say, لَسْتَ مُرْسَلًا. You are not truly a messenger of God. You are not a Rasul. You are just claiming to be a Rasul. How does the Prophet respond to that? Many times Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would give these answers to Rasulullah to console him, to assure him, if I may use the modern terminology, to boost his morale. Don't be disappointed with this rejection of the mushrikeen. And so Allah says to him, قُلْ, O Muhammad, don't worry about what they are saying. They are saying, لَسْتَ مُرْسَلًا, you are not a Rasul, don't care about it. Just say to them, كَفَى بِاللَّهِ شَهِيدًا بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَكُمْ وَمَنْ عِنْدَهُ عِلْمُ الْكِتَابِ. Say to them, I don't need your certificate. I don't need any certificate from you to say I am the Rasul of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For me it is sufficient, kafa, that Allah is the witness between me and you that I am his Rasul. The ayat could have ended here. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to Rasul, tell them, for me it is sufficient that between me and you on this dispute, whether I am a Rasul or not, Allah as a witness is sufficient. وَمَنْ عِنْدَهُ عِلْمُ الْكِتَابِ, and the one who has the knowledge of this book. Who is this other witness of the risalat of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam? Who was there in the cave of Hira when the wahi started with Rasulullah other than Ali ibn Abi Talib? And he says, فَأَرَاهُ وَلَا يَرِي يَرَاهُ غَيْرِي. Only I used to see him there. No one else would see him there. So if you really ask for somebody as a witness of that first revelation of the Quran on the Prophet of Islam, the witness is 10 years old, Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wasalam. Salawat ala Quran. Ekbar aur salawat kun diya. Man indahu ilmul kitab. Here kitab is the Quran. Of course, there are many, many different, you know, tafasir for this. There are different levels of tafsir. But this is from the Ma'asum themselves, where they say, وَمَنْ عِنْدَهُ إِلْمُ الْكِتَابِ, refers to Ali ibn Abi Talib. And historically, you link this with the statement of Ali in the khutbah number 192. This is where you see it makes very, you know, sense here historically. That the only witness to that revelation of the Quran when it started was Ali ibn Abi Talib, alayhi salatu wasalam. And the knowledge that he had about the Quran, and inshallah we'll talk about it more in the other majalis. But just a comparison here. When you look at the story of Prophet Sulaiman in the Quran, that when the queen of Sheba by the name of Bilqis was coming from Yemen, all the way from Yemen to Jerusalem, and Suleiman, in order to impress her, he wanted that the throne of Bilqis be brought to his court before she arrives there. There was a jinn there under the command in the army of Suleiman. We talked about it, the prophet who had control of the army of jinn. And he said that, you know, I can bring the throne of Bilqis before even you stand up from your throne. And set up, you know, stand up from your seat there. But the wazir of Suleiman, a human being, Asif Barqiya, a wali of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the wasi of the Rasul, he says, I can bring it even before you blink your eyes. And right there, it was there. Not even a second. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes this wazir by saying, وَمَنْ عِنْدَهُ عِلْمٌ مِنَ الْكِتَابِ. Those who know Arabic would know the difference between that sense statement and this one. وَمَنْ عِنْدَهُ عِلْمٌ مِنَ الْكِتَابِ. This was a person who had the knowledge of the portion of the book. Min here is for partiality. A part of the knowledge of the book he had. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O Muhammad, say to these mushrikeen, don't need your certificate. For me, that I am the Rasul of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the testimony of Allah is sufficient, as well as the one, man indahu, ilmul kitab, not ilmun min al kitab, who has the complete knowledge of this book. If Asif Barkhiya had that much power because of min al kitab, that he could bring the throne from thousands of miles, from Yemen to Jerusalem, at the blinking of the eyes, how can we even comprehend the power that Allah has given to somebody who is man indahu ilmul kitab? Salawat pranik para. This connection of Ali to the Quran and to Wahi is a very strong connection. You see, in the Battle of Siffin, where you see this is the importance of two symbolic Quran. There is one which is known as Quran Samit, the silent Quran that we read, the book. Then there is one Quran, we call it Quran Natiq, the speaking Quran, the embodiment of Quran, the one who can actually speak on behalf of the silent book. And Ali says in one of the khutbas, he says, you know, this is a book of guidance, but try to talk to it. Make it talk to you, you will not be able to do that. Because this book needs a spokesman, and the spokesman is the one who is going to speak on behalf of this book. So you need the Quran Samit, and you need the Quran Natiq. And we saw this difference there in Siffin, where Amir al-Mu'mineen was saying that they are actually using this Quran as Samit because it cannot speak. They can misuse it. Whereas I am the embodiment of this true Quran. Even though you have to fight against them, even when they carry the Quran on the spearhead, still fight with them because I am with truth and truth is with me. And this is where we realize that this connection between the Quran and Amir al-Mu'mineen is so strong. That when we look at the symbolism, even in this month of Ramadan, what is the importance of this book and this month? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the power of this month, all the barakat which is there. You know, Rasulullah in his first khutbah says that this is a month where anfasukum fihi tasbih wa nawmukum fihi ibadah. It's a month where your breathing process becomes a tasbih and a praise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's just like you are doing subhanallah, subhanallah, subhanallah. And even when you sleep in the state of fasting, your sleep is considered to be ibadat. Whereas we know that no ibadat is acceptable when you are sleeping. You need to be conscious. But in month of Ramadan, this month is so powerful that even our breathing process, as I said in the khutbah last week probably or the week before, something that we do not even do consciously, we do not are not even aware of it. It's automatically part of our nature. You know, Allah says this is tasbih. When you sleep in the state of fasting, this is ibadah. This barakat of this month of Ramadan is coming from where? When he says, kutiba alaykum as-siyam, fasting has been made wajib on you, And then later on he says, ayyam ma'dudat, you know, a fixed number of days. What are those days? Later on he says, shahru Ramadan. In the month of Ramadan you have to fast. How does he describe the shahru Ramadan? Shahru Ramadan allazi unzila fihi al-Qur'an. The barakat of the month of Ramadan comes from the nuzul of the Qur'an. From this descending of the Qur'an in Laylatul Qadr on the heart of the Prophet. Remember, there are two kinds of revelation. One is gradual and one is complete. Gradual is the one we started in Cave of Hira to the last days of the Prophet. But every year, during the month of Ramadan, in Laylatul Qadr, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would reveal, send down the entire Qur'an as a personal gift to the Prophet on his heart. And it is that revelation of Qur'an in Laylatul Qadr which gives this power to the Shahr Ramadan for all the barakat. And Amir al-Mu'mineen is this speaking Qur'an. The symbolism between the two is very powerful. According to my teacher, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give him a long life, Ayatollah Wahid Khurasani, he says, this is Laylatul Qadr, where the silent Qur'an descended on the heart of the Prophet. And it is the same Laylatul Qadr where the soul of the speaking Qur'an ascended to the heavens. That is the link between the speaking Qur'an and the silent Qur'an. When we talk about Amir al-Mu'mineen, you know, the issue of age is not really an issue when it comes to Ali. You know, he was Ali when he was 5 years old. He was Ali when he was 10 years old. He was Ali when he was 25 years old. He was Ali when he was denied his right. He was Ali when the Ummah came back 25 years after Ghadir, exactly by the day, to his door. He was still Ali. Whether he was an ordinary person working in the field of a Jewish, you know, person, or cultivating his own palm trees, or on the seat of Khilafat, or sitting on the minbar of Rasulullah, Ali was always Ali. And that is why when we talk about Ali in Quran, they are all together. This is the eve of the 19th of Ramadan, one of the three nights that we consider to be Laylatul Qadr. Azadarana Hussain, Hussain ke baba ke shahadat ki majlis hai ye, zarbat ki. Amir al-Mu'mineen apne مظہر عدالت کے عنوان سے ماہ رمضان کو بھی انہوں نے اپنی اولاد میں تقسیم کر دیا تھا. ایک رات ایک بیٹے کے یہاں رہتے تھے, ایک رات دوسرے بیٹے کے یہاں, ایک رات ایک بیٹی کے یہاں, تو دوسرے رات جو ہے دوسری بیٹی کے پاس. شب 19 وہ رات ہے کہ جو جناب ام کلثوم کے حصے میں آتی ہے. اکثر ہم یہ جملہ کہتے ہیں کہ جب ماں باپ اپنے اولاد جو ایڈلٹ اولاد ہیں ان کے گھر پہ جاتے ہیں تو ان کی خواہش ہوتی ہے, خصوصاً بیٹیوں کی, کہ وہ جتنا بہتر وہ جو ہیں ان کی خدمت کر سکیں. لیکن جناب ام کلثوم کے لیے مشکل یہ تھی کہ ان کے بابا علی تھے جو خلیفۃ المسلمین تھے, لیکن اس کے باوجود علی کا رہن سہن, علی کی لائف سٹائل بہت ہی سمپل تھی. افطار کے لیے جناب ام کلثوم جو ہیں صرف تین چیزوں کا سامنے لا کے لے آتی ہیں, نمک, روٹی اور دودھ کا ایک پیالہ. امیر المومنین نے دیکھا اور کہا کہ بیٹی, کیا تم ہمیں جانتے نہیں ہو؟ علی جو ہے روٹی کے ساتھ صرف ایک ہی چیز کھاتا ہے, ये दो चीजें जो हैं क्यों सामने रखी? बेटी ने माँ बाप की मोहब्बत के खातिर नमक को हटाना चाहा, अली ने कहा नहीं, नमक को रहने दो, दूध का प्याला हटा लो यहां से। अली खलीफतुल मुस्लिमीन थे, पूरे मुस्लिम एम्पायर के रूलर थे, लेकिन दो वजह है जो उस दिन वो कहते हैं कि दूध को उठा लो, सिर्फ हम इफ्तार जो है रोटी और नमक से करेंगे, इसलिए कि अली का रहन सहन और उनकी लाइफस्टाइल ऐसी थी कि अपने खुराक में भी अली इतना सादा रखना चाहते थे कि ममलकत इस्लामिया के बहुत ही दूर दराज का कोई फकीर भी हो, वो जब अपने उस दस्तरखान पर बैठेगा तो वो कहेगा हाँ हमारा दस्तरखान और मेरे मौला का दस्तरखान एक, वो हमसे रिलेट कर सकता है इस सिलसिले में। और दूसरी एक वजह थी जो अजीब गरीब है, यकीनन जनाब अम कुलसूम के लिए ये जुमला जो है तश्वीशनाक था। मौला फरमाते हैं कि एक चीज़ उठा लो, दूध को फिर कहते हैं हटा लो, इसलिए कि जब इंसान अपने रब से मुलाकात के लिए जाता है तो उसका पेट भरा नहीं होना चाहिए। एक लिहाज से अमीरुल मोमिनीन ने इंडिकेशन दिया जनाब अम्मु कुलसूम को कि मेरा वक्त जो है करीब आ रहा है। रिवायत है बीवी की कि ये पूरी रात अमीरुल मोमिनीन ने गुजारी है इबादत में, लेकिन अक्सर वो निकलते थे सहन में, आसमान की तरफ देखते थे कि फजर का वक्त कब आ रहा है, और जबान पर एक दुआ थी अल्लाहुम्मा बारिक ली हाज़िहिल लैल, कि खुदावंदा इस रात को मेरे लिए बाबरकत करार दे। किस बरकत की तलाश में थे अली? दर हकीकत अली जो है दर हकीकत चाहते थे कि वो शहादत का मर्तबा और जो आयात जंग बदर में नाजिल हुई हैं और उहद में, उन आयात को सुनने के बाद एक मायूसी सी चेहरे पे आ गई थी, जहाँ रसूलुल्लाह ने जब देखा कि अली तुम तो जीते हो इस जंग को, उस वक्त अली ने कहा लेकिन शहादत का मर्तबा मुझे नहीं मिला। उस वक्त रसूल ने कहा था ऐ अली यकीनन उस मर्तबे पर तुम भी फायज होने वाले हो, बस उसके लिए दुआ करते थे कि वो मर्तबा मुझे भी मिले। सुबह का वक्त होता है, फजर से पहले कुछ अमीरुल मोमिनीन तैयार होते हैं कि अब वो मस्जिद की तरफ जाएं, लेकिन जब तैयार हुए जाने के लिए तो उस वक्त जो है जनाब उम्मे कुलसूम आती हैं, कहती हैं कि बाबा आपकी तबीयत ठीक नहीं लगती है, इसलिए कि बहुत ही अनयूजुअल बात थी जो बाबा को देख रही थी, आप आज मस्जिद न जाएं और बेटों में से किसी को भेज दें कि वो जाके नमाज जमात पढ़ाए। लेकिन अली कहते हैं नहीं आज मुझे ही जाना है। जब जाने लगे, अजीब गरीब बात है कि वो इमाम है जिसको परिंदा भी जानता है, कुछ मुर्गाबियाँ घर में थी उन्होंने भी अली के रास्ते को रोक लिया, उन्हें भी एहसास हो गया कि ये अली का शायद आखिरी वक्त है। अली बस एक जुमला कहते हैं जनाब उम्मे कुलसूम से कि देखो तुम मेरे गम में मसरूफ़ हो जाओगी, ये ना हो कि इन जानवरों के दाना और पानी जो है ख़त्म हो जाए, बेहतर है कि इन्हें तुम आज़ाद कर दो ताकि ये परेशान न हो। अदार हुसैन अली जाते हैं मस्जिद में, हर नवाफिल पढ़ने के बाद जब वक्त हुआ फजर का, खुद ही अमीरुल मोमिनीन ने अजान दी है, लोग जमा होते हैं और जमात की सफ तैयार हो गई, अमीरुल मोमिनीन ने नमाज शुरू की है। वहाँ एक मलऊन मौजूद था जिसका नाम है इब्ने मुलजिम, इसने अपनी तलवार जो उस जहर में डुबाई हुई थी कि जिसका कोई दवा नहीं थी, वो तलवार को छुपे हुए अपने साथ रखे हुए था। अदादारान हुसैन जब अली ने नमाज शुरू की, क़याम के बाद रुकू में जाते हैं, रुकू के बाद सजदे में जाते हैं,
سجدہ ختم کرنے کے بعد سبحان ربی العلیٰ و بحمدہ ادارہ حسین، انسان جب سجدے سے اٹھتا ہے تو تیزی کے ساتھ اٹھتا ہے، یہاں علی کا سر بلند ہوا، ادھر ابن ملجم کی تلوار چلی ہے، اس طرح سے آ کے وہ تلوار پیشانی پہ لگی ہے، وہاں جہاں سخت زخم تھا عمر ابن ابن ود کی چوٹ کا جو خندق میں علی پر لگی تھی، بس علی نے فوراً اپنے ہاتھ کو آ رکھا اور ایک جملہ کہتے ہیں، فست و رب الکعبہ، کعبہ کی خدا کی قسم، علی کامیاب ہو گیا، میری تمنا شہادت تھی، آج خدا نے میری تمنا کو قبول کیا ہے۔ حضرت حسین ایک مرتبہ آواز بلند ہوئی آسمان سے، لقد انحدمت ارکان الہدا، ہدایت کے ستون گر گئے، اور اس کے بعد اعلان ہوا، الا لقد قتل امیر المومنین، امیر المومنین کو قتل کر دیا گیا۔ یہ آواز گونجی ہے کوفے میں، سب پریشان ہو گئے، بیٹیاں گھر میں پریشان تھی، لوگ جمع ہوئے اور بڑی تعداد میں مسجد میں، جب علی کے بیٹے انہوں نے اپنی بابا کی اس کیفیت کو دیکھا، حسر آتے ہیں اور بابا کو اپنے گود میں رکھتے ہیں، پٹی پر ایک پیشانی پر پٹی باندھی گئی، اتنے دیر میں وہ لوگ جو ابن ملجم کے پیچھے پیچھے دوڑ کے گئے تھے اسے گرفتار کر کے لے کے آتے ہیں، وہاں بھی دیکھیں کہ علی بھی اس حالت میں اپنے عدل و انصاف کو نہیں چھوڑتے ہیں، آپ سوچ لیں کہ اتنا درد ہو رہا ہے، خون جاری ہے، لیکن پھر بھی جب ابن ملجم سامنے آتا ہے، علی کی نظر جب اتنے آنکھوں کی طرف جاتی ہے، کہتے ہیں حسین اس کا خیال رکھنا، اس کے ساتھ مہربانی کے ساتھ پیش آنا، اس لیے کہ اس کی آنکھوں میں دیکھو خوف نظر آ رہا ہے۔ اس وقت امام حسن مشتبہ نے کہا، بابا آپ اس کی سفارش کر رہے ہیں، اس نے تو مجھے یتیم بنایا ہے۔ اس وقت علی نے کہا تھا، بیٹا یاد رکھنا تم رحمت للعالمین کے نواسے ہو۔ علی کو ایک لحاف میں رکھا گیا، اور گھر والے اور صحابہ جو قریبی تھے وہ اٹھا کے پھر چلے ہیں علی کے گھر کی طرف۔ گھر بہت دور نہیں تھا، لیکن جب قریب پہنچے ہیں اس وقت امیر المومنین کہتے ہیں، میرے اصحاب سے کہہ دو کہ میرے گھر کے قریب نہ جائیں، اس لیے کہ میں نہیں چاہتا ہوں کہ میری بیٹیوں کی رونے کی آواز جو ہے وہاں پہنچے۔ عجب نہیں کہ علی جو ہے کوفے والوں کو یاد دلا رہے ہیں، یہی بیٹیاں آئیں گی ایک دن قیدی اور اسیر بن کے، میری اس مظلومیت کو یاد رکھنا، میرے عدل انصاف کو یاد رکھنا۔ بس جب گھر میں لایا گیا، جب زینب ام کلثوم کی نظر پڑتی ہے، واہ علیہ، واہ محمد، اور واہ فاطمہ کا نعرہ بلند ہو جاتا ہے۔ فاطمہ حسین